the Danish West Indies. Today, I'm going to tell you a story that is going to blow your mind. A story that will let you weep. A story that will make you say, wow. Today, we're talking about Brifo. Brifo. Now, Brifo is a common account name. Our Brifo today is spelled B-R-E-F-F-U. But the correct spelling of the word Brifo is B-R-E-F-O. But this is what has been documented. Brifo, B-R-E-F-F-U. Now, Brifo was born right here in the Gold Coast. In fact, somewhere in 1700, circa. 1700, 1700. And she was born in Ekwamu, specifically at Ekwamu Fie. Now, if you have never been to Ekwamu Fie, take the advantage to go there and go learn about the people of Ekwamu. There was a time the people of Ekwamu conquered more than half the whole of this country today called Ghana. They conquered all the way into Benin and some other areas. In fact, they had the biggest land all over Ghana, and they were the most prominent Akan group known as the Ekwamu people. Now, are you aware that Osei Tutu's mother was never able to give birth until she visited a shrine? And this shrine was right there inside Ekwamu Fie. It was where she was serving, and she requested for a son from the shrine, and she truly had a child known as Osei Tutu. And Osei Tutu was made to serve in the shrine. In fact, it was while he was growing up in the area that he got in contact with Ntim Jakari. Now, Ntim Jakari was a very powerful king. In fact, he was a king who suffered from what is known as indecision. He didn't know whether to move left or to move right. I'm just giving you a background of the whole story. Now, it was in the palace of Ntim Jakari that Osei Tutu met the great Okonfo Anoche, who later became the backbone of the Ashanti people. Today, my brother, my sister, we are neither speaking about Osei Tutu nor speaking about Okonfo Anoche. Neither are we speaking about Ntim Jakari, nor are we speaking about the wonderful mother of Osei Tutu. Today, we are speaking about another woman by name Brifo, who was born in Ekwamu Fie in 1700, circa. And listen to the interesting thing that happened. She was born into the royal family, and she was being nursed to become a queen mother. Unfortunately, somewhere along the line, when she was barely 25 years, there was a war that took over a lot of the Ekwamu people, and she was carried all the way to St. John. And St. John is spelled S-A-I-N-T for Saint, and John is J-A-N. In fact, that is in the Danish language. In English, is John. Today is called Day. The Danish West Indies, my brother, my sister. This is the African history class. Now, see what happened.
Yabo! Yabo!
Brifo was carried all the way from Ekwamu Fie. Now, let me let you understand this properly, students. Now, the Ekwamus had become so powerful, they even came all the way and conquered the whole of Accra. So, the Ghans were under the Ekwamus. In fact, they had a great warrior known as Esimeni. Esimeni was the one who conquered the Danes and took over the Christiansborg Castle and the whole of Accra. Hey, this is a long history, but for now, let us just understand it like that. That the Ekwamus conquered the Ghans and took over the whole of Accra. They went ahead to conquer the Danish people from Denmark and took over the Christiansborg Castle. And then they went directly into trade with the people of Accra and also with the Danes. My brother, my sister, there was a time Esimeni even took over the keys of the Christiansborg Castle, locked it up. It's a long history. How he was able to go in there and he was able to learn the language of the Danes and got the trust of the Danes and was able to take them captive. My brother, my sister, it's a long story. But the Ekwami people were a very wicked people. You know what they did? They captured fellow Gold Coasters, or better still, fellow Ghanaians, as we'll call that today, and enslaved them. They enslaved the Gans, also enslaved people who were from other ethnic groups, even though they were Akans, but once they were not from Ekwamu, they were also captured and sold, like the Ashantis. They also sold the Fantis and some other people from around these areas. Now, the interesting thing is that the Ashantis also did the same thing. The Ashantis also captured slaves and they sold them out. The Fantis also did that. And the Kwamina answered the first. My brother, my sister. So it was a common thing. It was commonplace for ethnic groups to capture people from other ethnic groups and sell them into slavery. But the Ekwamu people topped the league, followed by the Ashantis. Now the Ekwamu people monopolized the trade with the Danes and now sold a lot of slaves to them and took guns and ammunition and some other such things in return. Now there was a great king of the Ekwamu people known as Asimeni. He was the one who was able to conquer the Danes and then he totally took over the whole trade and even enslaved some of the Danes. Now the Ekwamu sold a lot of slaves to the Danes who took them all the way to some islands including St. John. Now there was a war that broke out and the Danes were also able to take over. They fought the Ekwamus after the death of their king. When their king died in the days of Asimeni, the Ekwamu fear became very weak because their king was gone. And the Danes were now able to infiltrate. They captured a lot of the Danes, I beg your pardon, a lot of the Ekwamus, including our heroine for today, Brifo. So Brifo was also captured and taken all the way somewhere in 1725. Carried all the way to the island of St. John. And there the Danes had already started a sugar plantation. Oh my God. They had started using the indigenous people on the island, but they were weak and died from overwork, pest and diseases. So they decided to come to Africa to pick up the strong people of Africa. And when the Africans arrived, they worked their backs dry, working night and day on the sugar plantations, working for the Danes. Hey! Now, interestingly, one of the people from the royal home taken from Ekwamu Fie was called King June. King June. Certainly King June was not his original name. It was a name that was corrupted and perverted into June. J-U-N-E. He was called King June. And even whilst in captivity, he still served as the king of the Ekwamus. Remember, Brifo was also there. Hey! There were many other people like Prince Akwesi. They were all part of the people who were taken from Ekwamu. It came to a time the Ekwamu people formed the biggest. In fact, the Ekwamus alongside other Akans, they formed the biggest group on all the islands. Do you understand, students? It means that the Ekwamu people formed another colony right there in St. John. Bigger than any other black group on any of the islands. Oh my God. As their numbers increased, one day, Brifo went all the way to seek counsel with King June. He said, Nana, you know that we are royals. And that no circumstances should we rub shoulders with common slaves that we sold into slavery. And that no circumstances should we be treated the same. It is a disgrace for a royal to be treated like a slave. And the king said, but we are all in captivity. What do we do? It's time to unite. It's time to make all the slaves realize that we have to fight against the white man. The white man was our slave when we were in Akwamufie. How is it that all of a sudden the white man has become our king? These are people who do not even believe in kingship. They do not have any culture. How on earth should we ever become their slaves? Remember, everywhere we go, no matter how much in captivity we are, we still respect our kingship and we still remember our royalness. We must strike right now. Hey!
Yabo! Yabo!
My brother, my sister, interestingly, see what happened now. Now, as you can see the photo, in fact, a painting of Brifo, it also looks like the painting of Queen Nani. In fact, we use them interchangeably in history. They looked alike. No wonder history tells us that they both came from the Akan. So this one, this photograph, sometimes is used as the photo of Queen Nani. Other times, it is also used as the photo of Brifo. My producer is going to try and put up some other photographs of, in fact, how's it called? Brifo. So you can appreciate her more. Now, Brifo decided that she was going to go on the rampage. She decided to pull a lot of Ekwamu people. She didn't believe in the other people because she knew that a lot of them knew that they had sold them into slavery. So she decided to talk to only Ekwamu people. And she got 130 Ekwamu people. 130 of them. To come together for the big revolt. Oh my God. Remember, students, I said 130 Ekwamu people. She was able to take them in. Every night she trained them in guerrilla fighting with King June. Together they fought and fought and fought. They started the slave revolt, my brother, my sister. Oh my God, have mercy. In November 1733. Specifically on the 23rd day of November, 1733. It was a fierce battle. How did they do it? They started training all the 130 people in guerrilla fighting, and then they started stealing weapons. Yes, they started stealing weapons. They stole weapons, my brother, my sister, from the slave master. They stole weapons, hid the weapons and ammunition. Gradually, they were able, my brother, my sister, to start fighting. They fought and fought. All these slave traders, they fought and fought. All these terrible people who enslaved them. By beginning with the master of Brifo. Now, the master of Brifo was a very wicked man. He and his wife led a very, very wonderful, led a very, very wonderful life, eating and drinking, enjoying themselves. My brother, my sister, whilst the slaves worked themselves dry. Listen to what happened now. Now, Brifo, on the 22nd day of November, 1733, gave the order that at exactly 12 midnight, there should be a gunshot. And once the gunshot was heard, it meant that the Danes had gone to sleep and it was time to attack. At 12 midnight, there was no gunshot because some of the Danes were still alive. In other words, they were still awake. And then the gunshot came and she knew it was time to attack. She started off by reacting to the gunshot that came from Ford Frederick's van. Once she heard that gunshot, she attacked her own master. His name was Croyer. K-R-O-Y-E-R, and his wife. She slaughtered them in cold blood. She picked up the guns and ammunition and gave them strictly to only the Ekwamus, 130 of them. The Ekwamus alone went on the rampage, killing, shooting. The Danes, some of them were able to escape. In fact, two of them escaped. If they had known, they escaped. And then, now they gave the guns and ammunition to some of the members of the other ethnic groups who were not necessarily Ekwamus. And they took over the whole island. My brother, my sister. They took over the plantation. Yes. They took over the whole plantation. And they kept the plantation for 10 solid months, getting towards 1 year. What did they want to do? Number one, they wanted their freedom. And number two, they also wanted to be able to take over the whole of the plantation for themselves. They were tired of living in poverty. They were tired of being treated as slaves. So they wanted to own their money. In fact, while she was in a Kwamufie, she had her own money. She lived luxuriously. Now she was treated as a slave and she did not want it. They took over the whole place. And it was one of the longest slave revolts in the Americas. Now they took over the whole of the Coral Bay, the place known as the Coral Bay. And then they started dealing with the sugar plantations themselves and started doing business themselves. Unfortunately, the two people who escaped, they were able to go to the island of St. Thomas. And over there, they reported the matter to the Danes, who got in contact with the French because they knew the might of the Ekwamu people was so great. They wondered how a few people were able to take over the whole island. They believed that they had juju and they used black power. What did they do? They got in an alliance with the French and they came back to the island with full force, shooting and killing, shooting and killing. In no time, they were able to take over back the island, having killed a lot of the Ekwamu people. Now, Brifo realized that she was losing. And this was somewhere in May or April of 1734, a year after the revolt. And what happened? She decided to take her own life alongside 23 other people. In all, there were 24 people. All of them from Ekwamufie. They preferred dying to going back to live as slaves to the Danes. So they took their own lives. 24 of them in all. Today, when you go to the island of St. John, today known as the Danish West Indies. In fact, we still remember this great black woman, Brifo. She is the official queen of the island of St. John. They celebrate her. There is a huge festival celebrating the Ekwamu people right there inside St. John. There are traditional festivals that honor this great black woman known as Brifo. Sometimes Ekwamufie is invited to go all the way to St. John to be part of the ceremony. Today we remember you, Mami. You were the Ya Asantoa of the Ekwamu. You were such a great woman. You fought slavery. Interestingly, right after this one, in the early 1800s, Denmark abolished slavery, even though slavery still went on the islands. It was finally abolished in 1805. Today we remember you, Mami. Mami. Mami, why are you in the midst of men with only an army of 130 Ekwamu people? She took them through serious guerrilla fighting. She trained them and they mesmerized the whole of St. John and took over the whole place. Oh, If we had such women today, oh, if we had such women today, Africa would really be liberated. Mami, me se unia minko. Mami, me se unia minko. Mami, damir fadrio. Mami, me se minubeko. Mami, me se famikobio. She took her own life alongside 23 other people, 24 in all. They preferred death to slavery. Our mami. Mami misi wako kudro. Mami misi fami kobio. Our mami. Mami misi minubeko. Mami misi minubeko. Hey mami. Mami misi minubeko. Mami minubeko ati. Mami misi minubeko. Oh mami. Mami baba yo. Mami misi baba yo. Mami misi nakazaka kranche mi mami. Endugo kwa wankra mami. Mami wankra mi yo. Mami misi wankra o. Mami misi wankra o. Mami minubeko. Mami. In the burden of knowledge, I ask you, now that you know what to do, how will the life of Brifo impact your own life in modern times? Now that you know what to do, be an enio lea minio bafe, yen zunda kagane mezaka yine, ye pa bango boka yen nung, fifia ye nyanu kaina wo, banaehu ebeyeden, misi banaehu ebeyabade, lele anjima singa bekune, lele anjima singa beri, ao mami.
Tutu wavi, tutu wavi, papa mula homeo. Mamma mula homeo, how nai ma vigne, banum banum po, me ke po, fe mi via, buena, ne ma puena o, how vigne, ba fa vio. How na I ma vigne, banum banum po. How na I ma vigne, banum banum po. Na I ma.
This is 3FM.
Na I ma.
This is 3FM.
Are you feeling Irish?
Blakk!